about me first. I am a nurse. I started out at bedside nursing and did that for about 12 years. And then I went into infection prevention. And in infection prevention, we do a lot with math. We look at epidemiology. So what your project is going to do kind of aligns with what we're doing. Currently, we're in the middle of what?
Flu season.
Flu season, right. And one of the things we know about flu season is 1 year we'll have some, 1 year we'll have not that much, can be very mild. What are some of the things you think can contribute to how much flu we see?
Weather.
Mm-hmm. Tell me what, how?
Colder.
Okay, colder weather. Why would that affect it? Okay, cold weather, he said, one of the things he said is because you get sicker, you can get sick, and then if you get sick, you can get flu. And that is true. But I'm going to talk to you about science as well as math, because that's a part of this too. What we know about the flu virus is it survives in cold settings better than in warm settings. So this is a good environment. The way the weather has been is a really good environment for flu to survive. The other thing we know, and when you think about epidemiology and you think about disease processes, is we usually start seeing a lot of flu right after the holidays. Why would we see a lot of flu right after the holidays?
Because people are traveling.
Because people are traveling, okay. Where are they traveling to? To their family members. And what do?
Hug.
We hug. We kiss. We share drinks. We get together. I have a cold right now because I just visited my grandson. Gave me a big hug and sneezed right in my face. Right? Okay. So there's a lot more opportunity for sharing in that type of an environment too. That's why we see more of an increase right after that period of time. Now I have added some other things about some of the different ways we use numbers in science as well. I'm going to go through those. I'll do those a little quicker than I do this, but I want you to see some of the breadth of how we use math in lots of different ways. Because I know sometimes people say, yeah, we use it in this classroom, it will never be used again, so what? So I just want you to see how it can be used every day in lots and lots of different ways. Let's see if I get this right. So a lot of what we look at when you're looking at numbers, when you're looking at incidence cases, when you're looking at disease processes, can fit in different categories of this, especially in a hospital setting. We're definitely a business. We definitely need to analyze and look at what our numbers mean, because there is a purity in your numbers. What about math makes it true? What makes it true about math? That may not be a good way to phrase that. When you look at numbers, you don't argue about numbers because it's pretty objective, isn't it? It's not, I feel like right now we're seeing a lot of flu. If you feel like we're seeing a lot of flu, you may feel like we're seeing a lot of flu, you may feel like we're not. Okay, that's objective. It's not going to give you good information. And you want to make decisions, whether it be from a business, from an actionable item you're going to do, say in the public health setting, you want it related to good numbers and good data. So it's really important that we do have good data. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about epidemiology and show you. I'm going to show you a couple different ways you can demonstrate or visualize your information. And this is one of my favorites to use. Not this one. One slide too many. Okay. So here we are. Any of you remember Ebola? Anybody remember? Raise your hands. Okay. So what was the deal about Ebola? What's the big deal?
It's really deadly.
It's very deadly. It kills. Over 60% mortality rate. If that doesn't get your attention, I don't know what will. Anything else about Ebola?
Isn't it easily transmitted?
It's easily transmitted from person to person, depending on the environment you're in. Okay? Okay, so this is a map just to show you the different cases of Ebola, where this hit primarily, okay? The concern with Ebola is in the past, let's go back to way back. We're going to go to 1968 in the 60s. If we saw Ebola, they reported it through the World Health Organization, it would be limited to a village. And because of the way things were, we didn't travel a lot, there weren't established roads, it could be limited to that village. It may wipe out that village, but it wouldn't spread to other places, okay? Or it was rare that it would, or it may go to a couple close villages, but it wouldn't spread the way it did this time, okay? So we would see that. We knew about hemorrhagic fever, we knew about the different places it was. This Ebola was not different than other Ebolas. Same thing as in the 60s, okay, 1960s. The difference now is, now they have roads that connect all these villages. Now people travel to different areas very readily. Now people get on a plane and travel very readily. So that's where the issue was. The issue was it could spread much easier than it could in the past. Other things you have to think about with the disease are the traditions or the interactions that people in that country have. It's very important in these countries that after a person dies that you have contact with them, you touch them, you hug them. Everybody does. That's a part of the grieving process. Well, if you have a patient who has Ebola and you're doing that, what are the chances of that, those family members getting it? Much higher, right? And so you have to look at those pieces. Also, if you look in those areas, here we have a wonderful water and sewage system, all contained, very separate, right? In a lot of these villages and a lot of these areas, they did not have latrines. Or if they did, they had open sewers, which meant there was a gutter where the sewage would go down it. Now, if you have kids playing and they fall and they accidentally fall in it, they can get exposed, right? So teaching people how it spread and how to break the spread and that it's not okay to touch your loved one after they have died, a lot of those traditions are very hard to break. So there's a lot of work when you talk about disease transmission that goes into those pieces. And I know from your standpoint with the project, you're going to be looking quite a bit at how you want to present your data. So here's one way you can do it. It tells you the total number of cases in the different areas. Okay? So you can see on that map, you can see which country had the most, according to the map, what you see.
Sierra Leone,
probably, yeah. And so it can give you good information. You can see at a glance what is going on. And that's really important because you want to get your message and you want to get your message clearly to people. Now this is for what I call the right brain people because they like a picture. Pictures work for them. But are there left brain people who like to have tables? Oh, you bet, of course. Because if you're going to do a deeper dive into it, you're going to look into, okay, exactly where is it? I am the minister of the health minister of Sierra Leone. I need to give my resources to a certain area. Where am I going to give it to, and where do I need to push my resources as quickly as possible? So having a chart that gives you more information helps you see that. Now, when Ebola came out and we were talking about it, they talked about how it was here, but there also was a lot of reaction to the cases that were in other areas. Part of the reason you see so few cases here is because they confined and contained it and screened visitors here, okay? That's where you get into what I like to do, and that's the prevention piece of it. But you have to have good data here to make good decisions to see these kinds of numbers here. Okay? And so for all of the news, all of the resources, all of the screening that we did not only in other countries before they came here, but here when they came to our area, you can see here in the United States, there were 4 probable, suspected, or confirmed cases. Only 4. Okay? Total number of deaths in the United States? 1. Okay? So having good information, being able to give that information, being able to let people know, how did we know when we stopped seeing Ebola? How did we know when the crisis was over? We were tracking the number of cases. We were tracking the number of deaths. That's how you know. When can we not do all of this? So having good numbers, having good data makes a difference when you're doing that. If you all have questions as I'm going through this, just let me know, okay? So let's talk about what's going on right now. This is the United States in October, and this is our flu view map. And it shows us where we're seeing flu. Usually you'll see a random case of flu during the like August, September. Sometimes you'll see a little bit in October. For the most part, you don't see that much, okay? So this was October. This is November. You can see we're starting to see activity. The darker, the like Puerto Rico's already red, so it's widespread there. What is missing from these maps? I intentionally did it. What? A key. Hey, do you know what this means? Okay, when you're putting your data together, when you're presenting your data, you need to have a key to make sure you know and everybody understands, okay? That's something that a lot of people forget, or, you know, I'm going to make the map bigger, so I'm going to take the key off. Can you tell what's really going on here? Okay, so make sure you put your key on it. Okay, and here it's progressing, and then this was last week. So what does that tell you? Well, I'll show you in a minute because you'll have your key. But it's spreading, and you can see how it's spreading and how quickly it's spreading. So here's your key to show you the activity level. You can see right here in the Midwest, we're seeing lots of influenza. Okay, a lot of activity, a lot of transmission. That information, there's usually a delay of about a week because the things we reported last week are now gonna go on that map this week. Okay, because they have to get it. It goes to the health department. Health department sends it to the state health department, who sends it to CDC, who sends it to the World Health Organization. Okay, so that's how it tracks and goes through. And this was as of last week. See the transition? That's in a 2-month period of time. That's how much the disease is spread. And notice the difference it makes when you have that key there to look at it, to understand it. Okay. Are there any questions? Yes.
I noticed on the first map that Puerto Rico was bright red before, when most of the United States was green. Does it have anything to do with the tropical location at all, or do you think they just got cases first? Like, does the weather have anything to do with it?
I don't think the weather has anything to do with it. I think probably it hit there first. If you notice, their activity now is much lower. So with an epidemiologic curve, they've done this. Usually with an epidemiologic curve, it goes up, and then you'll see a second peak, and then it usually will start to go down and stay down. And that's what happened with Puerto Rico. They're through their flu season. We are right in the middle of ours. Okay? Good question. Other questions? So this is one way you can present it. And this is the table. And this may be hard to read, and I apologize for that. But this gives you and tells you by the region in Missouri. You can go to the flu view map at CDC and click on Missouri, and you can see what our different regions look like, how much we're seeing, and what type we're seeing. You can see we're seeing different types a lot of influenza A, H3 is what a lot of what we're seeing. Now, just to let you know, they don't type all flu. Every flu test they do, we don't type it. But we do type certain numbers of it. We randomize that and type it so we can get an idea of what is being spread. Okay, I wanted to show you this. This is another way to show how you spread disease. This is actually from, Singapore, and this is from 2003, and this is a person who has SARS, which is severe acute respiratory syndrome. Highly contagious, very much a concern. We did a lot of things to look at how we could prevent it. And we were very fortunate in the United States, SARS never did get here. But you can see here, these are the links. These are all the people that person had contact with. And then you can see this person had contact with this person, this person had contact with this person. This person had contact with this person who had contact with this person. Then had contact with this person, okay? You go out here, you can see the spread this way, and then these people really had contact with a lot of people. They were the people who shake hands, they're the huggers. They had contact with lots of people, okay? So here's another different way to display how contact or cases occur. Now when we're looking for that zero case, that's important to be able to track and follow this so we can follow that case and see how that, who that case is. How did that case happen? Like with Ebola, they found out that that case happened because a toddler went and was playing, and they were playing in a tree that had rotted out, but bats were living in it, and there was bat guano or poo, whatever you want to call it, in the bottom of it. And that toddler got exposed to it and developed Ebola. Mom took care of the toddler. Toddler got sick and died, and it started spreading that way. Okay, so that was our index case. Okay. Okay. I wanted to show you, now, that is the most important part for your project. And I want to really, if there are any questions you have about that, I want to focus on that. I did put some other information in about what we use math for in healthcare, but I really want to focus on this piece and see if you guys have any questions about this. Does it make sense? Is it giving you some ideas on how you're going to do your project? Okay. Okay, so I'm going to talk to you a little bit more about the things we use math for that I think you might find interesting. We use it all the time with product selection. For example, I tell people to wash their hands all the time. Well, how do we know what is the best soap to use in the hospital or the best hand sanitizer? We have certain criteria that we want our hand sanitizers and our soap to reach. So we look at the log reduction, and they actually have certain types of testing that they do through FDA to determine what the best product is going to be for us. Okay, so that's really important for us to have that information. We can't get that unless we have the math behind it to show us that and to demonstrate that it is effective. Here's another thing, ultraviolet light. Ultraviolet light is something, the sun has ultraviolet light. If you can capture ultraviolet light and use it effectively, it is a great disinfectant. It can clean things, like in this room. If all of you left and we put an ultraviolet light machine in this room, turned it on for the required time, it would kill all of the germs in this room, 99% of the germs in this room, virus, mold, bacteria, kill it all on every surface it could see. Okay, every surface it could touch. Think about that as far as cleaning this room versus going around and cleaning with a chemical. Okay, I'm going to clean your desk, but I don't leave the chemical on for the period of time it needs to be, or I don't rub it enough, or there's some goo on it that I need to clean off. Okay, so and then by the time I get over there, I'm really tired, so I kind of do this over the desk. Am I cleaning it effectively? Am I getting it clean? Think about the ramifications of that in a hospital setting. Well, they brought these UV light machines out and said, woo, we have this, it's great, it's wonderful, let's use it. And my job is to say, nope, time out. Show me how it works. Show me that it is effective and it will kill different organisms. That's exactly what this does. This shows us how effective it is against different organisms. And I know that Mycobacterium tuberculosis is very difficult to kill. And for it to be effective against it and kill it is important for me to know. So you take the information and you use it to make product selection and to make sure you have safe devices in the hospital. Okay, now you're gonna work on disease prevention. So I hear this all the time, really. I don't wanna vaccinate, it's not natural, it's not, you know, don't get me started about vaccination and the fact that it's so effective. If any of you wanna go out and look, there's a great Jimmy Kimmel Live YouTube on vaccination. He has a 9-month-old child. He went out and heard all these people were not vaccinating, which puts his daughter at risk because they could get active disease and expose her. So he is very much an advocate for it. So why do you get vaccination? Well, part of the reason you get it is because it's effective. Rubella, which is a type of measles, is something that when I was your age, it was very common. Kids got it. People got it. Usually we got it when we were little. Not a big deal. You had to stay home. And there was sequela to that. People died. People were blind. People became sterile. Lots of side effects of measles, okay, if you get them as a child. But it was normal for us. That's what we did. Well, then here we go. We have the first vaccine. And when the first vaccine came out, look at the incidence of measles in the United States, and rubella in the United States. What does that tell you? Is the vaccine effective?
Yes.
Is it something you want to do? So it gives you good information. Think of the number of people who didn't die who have much healthier lives now because of that. And this is the way to pull that information and look at that information. So as far as looking at disease prevention, if I'm going to spend money in the United States, I'm going to make sure every child has the opportunity to be vaccinated. Because we know it works, and it works well. Now you're going to see blips here, and the reason you see blips is because we do have people who now will not vaccinate because they don't think it's natural and it puts people at risk. So you can see here, this is the number of cases, and you can see we've had some blips here. And the reason we have is because people don't think it's important. And so then somebody gets measles, and we're seeing some of it in the United States where we hadn't seen measles for a long time. And what that meant for me is, I saw measles, but I'm a lot older than you guys are. And a lot of the doctors are younger than I am, and they've never seen a case of measles because the vaccine works. So it's a real interesting perspective for it. Okay. The other thing we do is look and see if it's effective. So, all right, we did it. We got measles. We're good. Then you have to go back and check and see how things work. And what we found is one dose of measles, MMR, is not enough. It wasn't protecting enough. So, you know, it's not just resting on your laurels, it's continuing to ask questions. The beauty of what you guys do is you're going to continue to challenge and ask questions on things we think are normal. And you're going to change things for the better because you're asking questions and you're curious. And that's, I'm counting on that. Because when I'm old, I want y'all taking care of me and asking questions and making it better. So, we looked at it and decided, you know, we need to give 2 vaccines. Okay. Another thing we use MAP for is looking at how disease transmission occurs. For example, droplet spread, large droplet spread, small droplet spread, droplet nuclei diameter, looking at that. We look at how big these organisms are and how they transmit. For example, for flu, it's a droplet spread, which means I cough it, it will fall about 3 feet from where I cough it from. If I'm talking about tuberculosis, a different disease, it will float in the air for a long period of time because it's that small. So looking at size and diameter and measurements and putting formulas together help us decide what is transmitted, how it's transmitted, and the most effective way to protect ourselves from it, which is really important. We use it to look at air patterns. If we have a person with TB, we want to make sure they're in a room where it's vented into the room and is exhausted out and goes over the patient. Okay? So as that healthcare worker comes in, they're in the safest possible environment they can be in. So we use engineers to help us determine what that looks like, how many air exchanges we need, what the temperature and humidity needs to be in those rooms to do that. The other way we use data is we use it to do risk adjustment, and we use it to look at quality. This is looking at, we risk stratify and score according to how we're performing, which this is our scorecard we use. And one thing about data is, when you're in a position like I am, I'm presenting information to everybody from a housekeeper, a person in food service, to the board level. And they may not understand math. They may not understand statistics. So we color code according to blue as we're doing very well, red as we need to improve. This is a caution, and green as we're meeting our goal. So we take that, do our risk stratification, and then we determine what our greatest risks are. Because I can't work on everything. I can't work on everything on this list. But there are certain things I can work on. And to drive that, we also use individual data for different units. This is a unit, I'm just showing you some information we give them every month. For this, I use only two colors, orange and blue. Blue means you're meeting your goal, orange means you're not. Now you can look at the data to see what it is, but just by looking at the color, you know that we need to work on getting the number of central lines on our unit down. That's what that's telling us. You have too many for the number of patients you have. So very quickly they can see that and know where they need to work. Because again, they have a lot of things they need to do. So this gives them that kind of information. And we want to do it in a way that it's easy for them to understand. So color coding always helps. This is our hand hygiene rates. Here we're giving the information. We're giving them the actual numbers we've observed. We've got it by our clinical support, by our nursing, and by our medical staff. So they can see how they're performing. We want them to know how they're doing. And we also want them to compete with each other so they're doing well. Now this you can see, this is LeapFrog, which is a quality institute. If you were coming in and you were, let's say your mom is gonna have to have a C-section. Doctor says she's gonna have to have a C-section. And you want her to go to the best hospital. How can you tell which of these hospitals is the best? Is it because you like the doctor? Is it because your uncle knows a person who works on one of the units? Is it because they have free soda while you're in delivery? Well, you want good data, and what we are charged with is giving good data. So according to this, Hospital 1 has a 30% C-section rate, 8% mortality on risky procedures, and has a C for LeapFrog. Hospital 2 has 11% C-section rate, 1% mortality on risks, and a LeapFrog rate of A. Hospital 3, 14% C-section rate, 3% mortality rate, and a B LeapFrog. So which one would you want to go to? Two, right? You have better information because there's good data. That data, behind that data, is a lot of math to get you there, okay? It doesn't just happen, you don't pull it out of a hat. These are all very objective, okay? Okay, I want to make sure we have time for questions. How do we use math to help our patients? Well, if I identify that your mother has a risk for stroke, I'm going to give her this sheet and every one of these risks on here have data behind them. They have screened, they have asked questions of a lot of people who have developed stroke to get this information. We've taken that information, we've looked at it, we've prioritized what the risks are. Now we're giving this to your mom and having her check where she is on this stroke profile. Then we're going to educate her related to that. So see how important that is to have that kind of information to help your mom's outcome. So she understands what her risks are. She gets off the couch, she stops taking too much salt, she starts eating better and managing her blood pressure. Okay? So this is a good tool that we can use, taking math and formulas and pulling it to the point where your mom can use it to make checks to look at her risks. Y'all know about pi, right? You know why it's important? Why is it important? Anybody? Pi tells you there's a statistical significance. That is important when you're looking at do things work, and I'm going to give you an example. So I want you to think of this as your grandpa, your great-grandpa maybe, and he came in, and you know what? He has a central line-in, okay? And so since he has a central line-in, and I'm a nurse, I know that central line goes right down to his, in his, to right by his heart, right here. So I don't want that to get infected, do I? No, I don't want it to get infected. So everything we do to that line, from the time we put it in to the time we take it out, we want to do the right thing, correct? How do we know what the right thing is? We know people are going to be touching that line. They're going to be putting medications through it. That's the whole point of it, okay? So we want to make sure they're doing the right thing and using the right thing to make sure that patient is safe. This is a study that was done, and in this study what they did is they used alcohol to wipe before they accessed that line every time. Then they did that for 2 years, and they monitored the number of central line infections they had. Then they took that same population, those same units, and they used a chlorhexidine with alcohol and did the same thing, same lines, same patient population, essentially, okay? And what they found by doing this is the results show them that before they changed, there were 12 catheter-associated, central line-associated bloodstream infections when they were just using the alcohol. When they switched it to the chlorhexidine, it fell to 3 in that same time period. So it is statistically significant with a p-value of 0.004. And so this is another way we use math, and this is a great way to clarify what is an outlier, what is really important to look at. So what they know and what I know as a nurse is, if I'm going to be taking care of a patient who has a central line, I'm going to want to use the chlorhexidine with alcohol. And actually that now is a national standard. But it took people looking at it, gathering data, and looking at statistical significance to make it important. I just wanted to put this in. So if Excel does this all, why do I need to know this stuff? Well, quite frankly, the reason you need to know this stuff is, don't you think if I were wrong, I'd know it? You can take and put one number in the wrong place and get misinformation. So clarity and knowing how to do your math and how to interpret it is really, really important, because you can make differences by using it and the way you use it. So I'm going to stop there and see if y'all have any questions for me. I know it's a lot of information, and I know it's first hour. Those are both against me. But do y'all have any questions?
I've got one.
Yes.
Oh, here, Bryce, you go.
I was wondering, since you've been working there, what was like the largest outbreak you saw?
In when H1N1, the new flu came out and they said that pandemic flu came out, that was probably the largest outbreak of flu I saw, the largest outbreak of a disease. And people, the thing is, people died from that, and young people died from that. So that is always hard when you're in healthcare to see that. Because you want to do all of this, and then you don't want anybody to die. But the reality is people do, and that's very, very difficult to see. But I will tell you, even with a small outbreak, if we had a small outbreak, maybe 3 babies in our NICU that got sick, that would be devastating too. When you have somebody die, it is a concern. And you look at things like exponential rise, and when you're looking at epidemiology, high numbers, but like the central line bloodstream infection, you're talking about 3. But if 3, it, so if out of that, if you have, what was the first number? 12?
Yeah, it was 12.
Okay, so you have 9 people who in the next 2 years went home to be with their family rather than getting a bad infection and possibly dying. That's a success too, even though it's small numbers.
Yeah.
Yeah. What are some of the contagious diseases that you see affect Liberty the most?
Okay. Definitely, we see right now influenza is one of them. We see some disease. Sexually transmitted diseases. We see that definitely, and it's reported through the health department, and that definitely affects people and affects babies. We also see foodborne diseases like E. coli. Salmonella, we see some of that. Another one that we see that isn't reported to the health department, but you can find numbers on it, is norovirus. And norovirus is very easily spread. It takes a very small amount of the virus to cause disease. It's also called the cruise ship virus. And it's something that you see can spread through schools too. That's why washing your hands is so important. Foodborne diseases are things that definitely you'll see them come and go. Another one we've seen, and we do have a vaccine against it, but not everybody gets it. And we see it's cyclical. You'll see it in Missouri. It kind of goes to St. Louis and then comes back to Kansas City, then goes to St. Louis. Is pertussis, also called whooping cough, Bordetella pertussis. So I think those are probably some of the most common ones. Yes.
With STDs, would that be a seasonal thing at all? Or would it just be like a steady growth over the year at all? Or would there be a spike at some point?
Usually with STDs, you see more around the holidays and then during the summer, a lot more during the summer. I could do a whole talk on that, but I'm not. But anyway, okay. So, anything else? Any other questions? Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate it.